As we reflect on the virtues of St. Mary and as we look at the gospel, not only of this morning, but also of Vespers of last night, we are kind of caught by this emphasis on obedience. Last night, as a woman, if you remember the gospel of the Vespers, a woman yells, Christ, blessed is the womb that bore you, and Christ yells back, blessed are those who hear the word of God and do it, those that keep it. Those that obey, those that do the will of God can become the brother, the sister, even the mother of the Lord. This morning, I wanted just to think about this idea of obedience, this idea of this virtue of obedience that can propel mere humans, mere very faulty humans, into these great, great positions. At the core of the issue is that obedience is the problem of humanity. From the very beginning of our creation, Adam and Eve were given control over everything. They were given authority over everything. One single stipulation: don't do this one thing. Everything else I've given to you, you have complete authority, you have complete power over nature, over animals, but one thing: don't eat from this one tree. And they couldn't do it. They couldn't do it. At the core of the problem of humanity from the very beginning is a problem of obedience. When you look at the scripture, especially throughout the Old Testament, but also into the New Testament, the struggle that is constantly there is the struggle between God's commandments and God's faithfulness and humanity's disobedience. When you look especially again in the books of Moses and those of the prophets, it's the same story over and over again, told in a variety of ways, but it's the same story over and over again. God is faithful, humanity is disobedient. When we look at obedience and the concept of obedience, obedience is difficult. It kind of goes against the grain of our thinking, of our natural reaction. To obey is to give in to another authority. Our society and ourselves, just psychologically, we're almost hardwired to go against that. It's counterintuitive. And, you know, you see it all over. Just with my young children, I'm sure all of you that have children have noticed the same things. You ask them to do something, the first reaction is going to be one of two things: no or why. And then you engage in a long debate, a long discussion, sometimes, unfortunately, just ending up because I told you so. But the initial response is always of disobedience. It is no, I will not obey you. I can do it my way. I know how to do it. I do it better. In our world, obedience is almost a vice. It's not a virtue. Obedience is almost admittance of weakness, that somebody who is obedient is weak. They don't have the internal strength, internal confidence to stand up for themselves. When we look at the church, however, when we look at the scriptures, when we look at the ways of God, obedience is a supreme virtue. You have monks and nuns who spend their entire lives just trying to attain that one single virtue. And I've shared this definition with you before, but it's the one I like. John Climacus, a Greek father, who defines obedience as the intentional setting aside of one's will. To be obedient is not weakness. Obedience is not that you do not have confidence in yourself. If we look at this definition, it is a very intentional act. It is a very courageous, it is a very difficult act. It's the intentional setting aside of one's will. At its deepest on purest level, obedience is an act of love. It is an act in which humans can imitate God's love. Ultimately, obedience is to imitate Christ, who, having all power, all authority on heaven and earth, repeatedly, the gospel says, not my will, but yours. That the trip to that cross, again, setting aside the will, but doing the will of the Father. In some ways, this is kind of we can plot this as the plot of the trajectory of maturity in God's obedience. Sometimes it will start with a no, with a why, with a long dissertation as to how about this, how about that, and eventually, ultimately, the mature Christian, the person who is mature in God, simply does it. Reminded by the story of Abba Pompo, one of our desert fathers. One day, four monks come to his cell. Each of them are sitting there speaking with the elder, and each one is not speaking about their own virtue, but they're speaking about their neighbor's virtue. One talks on and on about how one of these four monks is full of charity. Everything he gets, he constantly gives to the poor. Another mentions that his neighbor doesn't have anything. He lives, his cell is completely empty. He is the epitome of poverty. Another one comments on his neighbor and he says, my neighbor fasts greatly. He is a great ascetic. He is fasting constantly 2 and 3 days. In the fourth one, the only thing they could come up with is that he lived with an elder for 25 years, serving an elder, obeying an elder for 25 years. Not particularly good at fasting, not particularly the epitome of poverty. He simply lived with an elder for 25 years. And then when they turned to the great Abba Pompo, Pompo told them the greatest of the monks is that fourth one. Because whereas each one of them was doing their own will, was seeking out their own virtue, is that fourth monk who set aside his ego, set aside his own intentions in order to serve another. And then he concludes by telling them, of such men, that fourth monk, of such men are martyrs made. Over and over again in the scriptures, in the history of the church, we are met with these examples of individuals who take obedience to a very radical extent, to a very extreme extent. And in every case, you see that this radical, this austere form of obedience leads to an abundance of mercy, an abundance of grace. We all know the story of John the Little. Here's a stick, water it. John doesn't bargain. John starts watering a stick in the middle of the desert. Almost 1,600 years later, we are still talking about John. A man who set aside his logic, set aside his intentions in order to obey another. When we look at Abraham, the father of the patriarchs, Abraham's life is one test of faith after another, one test of obedience after another. Initially, God tells him, get out of your country, leave your kindred, leave your father's house. I will lead you to another country, to another place. Now, a very normal reaction there was, no, I'm fine here. Or, I'm glad that we're on speaking terms. About the plot right next to mine. We don't have to travel halfway around the known world at that point in order to reach this land. There's plenty of good land right here. But Abraham, through his obedience, doesn't do any of that. He doesn't bargain. Doesn't quip. He simply obeys. Later on, he is met with another challenge, another test of his obedience. He is told to sacrifice his one son, his beloved son Isaac. Again, when you look at Abraham is one of these figures. The scriptures are full of them. But when you look at Abraham and what Abraham is asked to do and what he does, you almost just have to stand there in silence. Abraham doesn't bargain. How about my cattle, my wealth, instead of Isaac? He doesn't rationalize. You told me I'm going to be the father of nations. I'm an old man. You give me one son, and now you want me to sacrifice for it. Does that make any sense? He doesn't blaspheme. Abraham grows up in a polytheistic society. The easiest thing is, well, this God wants me to sacrifice my son. There are literally hundreds more that don't require that. But rather than any of that, Abraham obeys. And when we look at the scriptures, it says that the following morning, so Abraham rose early in the morning. He didn't even procrastinate. I don't know about you, but any trip that I'm not all that excited about, I'm staying in bed. Not even does Abraham procrastinate. Early in the morning, gets up, obeys. We talk about faith and works, and sometimes we get into these esoteric, meaningless discussions about faith and faith alone and faith and works, so on and so forth. Look at the life of Abraham. Look at what Abraham is doing. Abraham's faith is his action. Abraham's faith is his obedience. Abraham didn't just simply believe that he was speaking with God, that he entered in the covenant with God. He acted on that. It is through the actions, not some sort of esoteric intellectual faith. Imagine if Abraham just simply believed and didn't do anything. That's not faith. We know faith in Abraham because his faith is an action. His faith is expressed in obedience. A few weeks ago, we discussed the disciples and the feeding of the multitude. Again, they are asked to do something illogical. The disciples obey, and because of their obedience, they, the multitude, are fed. And they are fed by something far greater than the manna that their fathers had eaten. We are reminded by Christ as he met Peter, James, and John after a long night of toil, a long night of fishing. He tells them to do the exact same thing they've been doing. And they do it. They are obedient. And because of their obedience, even when it doesn't seem logical, even when it doesn't seem right to them, because of their obedience, they end up with two boats that are brimming, that are almost tottering with fish. And more than that, it changes their entire life, their entire career. When we look at the Virgin, when you look at the Virgin Mary, a virgin woman being told you are going to have a son without a father. Now, the virgin was young, but she understood that this is completely illogical. This is unnatural. This doesn't make any sense. And what elevates, what propels the virgin, makes her even more glorious than the angels, as we say, is her response, "Let it be to me according to your word." In many ways, the scriptures and the church are just constantly asking us very similar things. Because the same one who told the virgin that she is going to conceive, that he told Abraham to sacrifice his son, and before that to leave his land, the same one who told Peter to go into the deep, is asking us to be obedient. The problem is our response. Is our response similar to that of Abraham, to that of Peter? Or is it similar to small children where our first reaction, our innate reaction is first no, and then why, and then, well, let's parse this out and see if we can get around it. Far too often when we speak about obedience and obedience to God's commandments, we're kind of aiming for compliance. It's not really obedience, it's just simply compliance. I'm going to do the absolute minimum for the letter of the commandment. So that's why I don't break it. Sometimes when we think about our relationship with God, sometimes we think about it in a negative way, not as it's bad, but we go through the whole things that we haven't done. I'm obedient to God, haven't killed anybody this morning, haven't stolen, haven't done anything really outrageous, haven't coveted anything lately. I'm good. This morning, today, let us evaluate our obedience to God. Let us think about this note with whether or not we are doing our will or His will. And to what extent are we completing His will? Are we like Abraham, like Peter, where we get that commandment and we go out and enforce it, we put it into action? Or are we still like small children, dragging our feet, saying no, and why? The one thing we are assured of is that those that are able to achieve that virtue, to reach that virtue of obedience, as we are told in the last verse of today's gospel, those are the brothers, sisters, and mothers of the Lord. And glory be to God.